Alright, hey everybody, welcome to Planes Overhead, and we are continuing with our A320 series, and today we're going to do autoflight. Actually, autoflight is one of the largest systems of the Airbus A320 aircraft, and it is literally practically impossible to do them in n number of videos actually. So what I'm going to do in the autoflight systems is we're going to do the basics and fundamentals so that you are able to connect to the system, and then when you actually go through the FCOM, you'll find it easier to connect to whatever is given there. Alright, so the disclaimer remains the same. I do not recommend any practical application of whatever you're studying here. Of course, for autoflight, because that is one of the most critical systems on the aircraft since it's highly automated. Before we actually begin autoflight, I want you to go back to the first video on the A320 series and have a quick look on that, because that is going to help you locate these components. So autoflight system comprises majorly FMGS, MCTU, FCU, FAC. FMGS is Flight Management Guidance System, MCTU is Multipurpose Control Display Unit, FCU is Flight Control Unit, FAC is Flight Augmentation Computer. So MCTU is the one that's on the pedestal, and the software that's loaded is the FMGS inside it. FCU is on the glare shield, and FAC is a computer again. FMGS consists of two major sections. As the name suggests, FMGS has management and guidance. Similarly, flight management and flight guidance. Flight management deals with navigation, flight plan predictions, etc., all the calculations. Flight guidance will give you guidance depending on the flight plan. So the autopilot is in the picture, flight directors, autothrust commands. Okay. So this is a system interface that I've made for us to understand easily. And let's just consider FMGS to be the CPU sort of stuff, where it is the one that is actually doing all the processing that is required. Okay, so it's the centralized place. Now FMGS consists of two computers, Flight Management Guidance Computer 1 and FMGC 2. So these two computers are completely independent of each other, and they do all the calculations separately and then share it with each other. The two arrow marks indicate they share the data with each other. So that helps in cross-verifying whatever they have calculated is accurate. And it is really, really accurate, and that helps in removing errors completely. So to process something, we need input and then we'll get the output. So the left side, we have inputs, FCU, Flight Control Unit, MCDU 1 and 2. Outputs are flight directors, autothrust, MCDU 1 and 2, radio navigation. Okay, so FCU is short-term navigation management, MCDU is long-term navigation management. As we go through the video, we will learn about each of them separately. So that's about the overview, and let's begin with FCU, okay, in this video. So FCU is flight control unit, and it is in the middle of the glare shield on the top of the cockpit. And it is used for short-term navigation management. Now, what does that mean is, short-term navigation management means you want to maintain certain parameters for short term. Example, even though the flight plan has a, A to B destination, but due to ATC traffic constraints, suppose example, he might tell you to maintain runway heading for some time. So all you can do is set your runway heading on this, and then the aircraft will fly the runway heading for some short time. As and when you require, you can just remove it. So this FCU panel, the whole panel is used for short-term navigation management. MCDU, which is on the pedestal, is used for your long-term navigation management, which has your flight plan loaded inside. Okay, so let's begin with the details of the FCU. So FCU, and actually those of you who have already type-rated, you might find this video very basic, but then this is the fundamentals, and that's all we can talk about on this video. So speed Mac, this clicker here, is the one that will change the unit. So this speed is generally in knots, but if you want it in Mach number, if you click this, it will change to Mach. But by default, while climbing, it changes to Mach around flight level 300. Why? Because above that level, you actually are in a zone where you'll enter Coffin's Corner, and you need Mcrit values, maximum Mach number and everything. So hence, it will automatically change to Mach. Next, we'll talk about the speed knob. So speed knob is to select speed. If you turn it left, it'll decrease. If you turn it right, it'll increase. Now, before we actually begin these knobs, there are two terms, selected and managed. Selected is when the pilot is selecting. Managed is when the computer is managing the parameter. So in this case, if you want to select the speed, you will pull the knob and select the speed as desired. That will be the selected speed by the pilot. Okay, and it will display here. When you push the knob inside, if the knob is pushed inside, it is called manage speed, and the computer is going to calculate what speed it is maintaining. Alright, so that suppose it's climbing, it will maintain a climb speed. If it is cruising, it will maintain economy speed, or whatever speeds are there, it will calculate and maintain itself. When it is doing so, it will show here dash that I am in control. It will show something like this, three dashes and one dot. It indicates it's managed speed. Okay, so these are the two ones, select speed, manage speed. Moving on to heading. Heading knob is as similar as the speed knob is, just that it is physically little different. It has some, you know, physical attributes that differentiate it from the speed knob. That is in case, suppose if the ATC has told you turn heading left 080, you should not by any chance be selecting, you know, speed knob 080, because that is too low for the aircraft to fly. Alright, so it is given physical difference, so when you touch it, you know the difference. So the heading knob, same one, if you turn it left, it will decrease. If you turn it right, it will increase. And if you want to select it, you pull the knob and that will be the pilot selecting the heading. And if you push the knob, the FMGC will select the heading depending on the flight plan that is loaded in the MCDU. So, and when it is managed, it will again turn dash, dash, dash and a dot. So that will indicate that the heading is managed by the MCDU, the FMGS itself. One push button is given here. It is called lock. This is the localizer push button, and it is used for non-precision approaches when your glide slope has failed on a certain airfield and you have only localizer available. So if you press this button, this will turn green. These stripes here will turn green, in indicating that the aircraft is engaged to the localizer and it will fly the localizer. But you have descent on your hand. Okay. Next, in the middle here, we have some clickers and push buttons, heading, track, vertical speed, FPA, which we will discuss at the end of the video. Autopilot and autothrust we will discuss in a different video altogether. Alright, so I'm just leaving this for now. Next, we'll talk about altitude knob. Now, altitude is the same as these two knobs. You pull it to select altitude. Suppose you're parked at the bay and your cleared altitude is for the flight is flight level 35350. But due to traffic constraints, initially the ATC has told you to maintain 240. So what you can do is set 24,000 here and then pull it. Okay, so for some time, short term navigation, it will maintain 240. When the ATC said, okay, resume normal navigation, all you have to do is just press it inside and the FMGC will select the altitude depending on the flight plan. And this is called managed altitude. Okay, I hope that is clear. If you push it, it's managed. If you pull it, it's selected for all the three knobs. Another interesting thing about this knob here is hundreds and thousands, as you can see, hundreds and thousands. So you have the option to select in, you know, differences of 100 and 1000. So if suppose you have to set 10,400, all you have to do is select this to 1000 first, move it to 10,000, then select it back to 100 and then select 400. So that will give you 10,400. Now the last important thing about the altitude is when you push it, it is not going to show any dashes here. There will be no dashes here. Okay. It is always constantly going to display a value, whichever is selected or whichever it is going to fly. Because altitude is very critical in a highly congested traffic zone, and it is important that the pilot is always aware what altitude he is maintaining or he is going to maintain. So that is always displayed and it's not never going to be dashes. Another button I would like to talk about is the exped here, though I have not written about it. As far as I have heard, these buttons are no more installed on the aircraft. What this exped button does is it stands for expedite. So expedite is when your ATC is asked you to expedite climb, expedite descent due to traffic constraints, traffic below, traffic above. So if you press this button, what happens is the aircraft goes into the maximum vertical gradient possible. So it will climb maximum in the shortest distance possible. So that will be expedite button. And this another clicker here is metric alt. It is similar to speed mark and it will give you units in meters, as you can see here. This is generally in feet. If you press this, it will go to meters. Alright, now we'll talk about the last knob, the most interesting knob, and it is vertical speed. So the knob is also mentioned up and down, so it selects rate of descent or rate of climb. Okay, by default the vertical speed is maintained by the FMGC according to the flight profile, so it will maintain the it will automatically calculate the required vertical speed. But if you have to select, the pilot wants a specific vertical speed to be maintained, maybe in case of an emergency, or maybe because of ATC restrictions, he could tell you reduce rate of descent. So, you know, that time what you do is select, move this down or up, whichever, rate of climb, rate of descent, and then pull it. So pull the knob to select desired VS. Now here comes the interesting part. When you push it, it's written also here clearly, if you push it, it actually levels off. Okay. Whatever altitude you are at, current passing or whatever you're maintaining, if you push it, it will go, the VS vertical speed will become zero. All right. So this knob is different from the other three knobs. All right. The last push button here is approach. Now, this is similar to lock. Lock was in lateral profile only localized. So there was no glide slope. But if you press approach, both your lateral and vertical profiles are engaged. As in localizer and glide slope, both will be ready to be captured. So approach push button is used for your full letdown. All right. So I hope the FCU panel is clear. Now we will talk about the heading track vertical speed FPA, and autopilot and auto thrust anyway will be on a different video altogether. So now the heading vertical speed track FPA, they actually give you the PFD to reconfigure. Before we actually start off this, if you click this button, the heading knob becomes a track knob. The vertical speed knob becomes the flight path angle knob. All right. So if you select here, it'll be flight path angle. If you select here, it'll be track here. If you click this, and this will heading VS will be moved, and it'll show track FPA. So anyway, before we actually start the discussion, I would like to give some definitions on that. Heading is whatever your nose is pointing at currently. Vertical speed is rate of climb or rate of descent that the aircraft is maintaining. Examples are plus 300 feet per minute is a climb, minus 700 feet per minute is a descent. Okay, etc. Track. Now, track is heading corrected for wind. It is different from normal heading. It is a heading that is already corrected for wind, and you'll maintain that. FPA is flight path angle, and it is the angle with the horizon. So plus 2 degrees, minus 3 degrees. Minus 3 degrees are general standard glide slope angle, right? So that is flight path angle. Now, let's start a discussion on this. So if you are in heading VS mode, the PFD, the primary flight display, which is part of the FS, electronic flight instrument system, will show something like this, heading, in the heading VS mode. Okay, so this is how a PFD will look, and you will fly the heading in this. Once you click this, what happens is you will have track written here. Okay, and that symbol, FDs will change something like this. This is called a bird. It looks like an aeroplane from the behind. So it is basically, you are the aeroplane and the bird is you. Okay. So what is the advantage of track FPA? Now, track FPA, first advantage is it is giving a correction for the wind directly. Suppose track is selected. If you remember, the heading knob changes into track, right? So suppose you have selected 005 here. Now, if you select 005, a blue line appears here. And all you have to do is fly this bird onto the blue line, and it will maintain the track. It will give the wind correction by itself. You don't have to calculate. There's no wind correction required to be calculated. And another thing, important thing is, now if you want to maintain level flight, all you have to do is maintain the bird on the horizon like this. If it is on the horizon, it will maintain level flight irrespective of whatever the configurations, whatever the conditions are of the aircraft. Okay, it will maintain level flight. If you want to descend at 3 degree glide slope, you just place the bird over here, wherever the 3 degree is showing. So it will just somewhere here, you'll just place it on 3 degree, it will descend at 3 degree. Even though you change the configurations, it will maintain the 3 degree glide slope. Okay, so this is generally used in non-precision approaches. It is used in our visual approaches. So track FPA is used. Okay, and another way to, you know, just for information, this bird is towards the right, so the winds are coming from the left. Okay, this is very important as well. All right, so actually this track FPA and heading vertical speed concept will be much more clear if you're actually sitting into a simulator and flying it yourself. And I've given you the basics to understand it, but once and more you practice with it, you will get hold of it very quickly. All right, so I hope you've understood autoflight FCU, and I think that's all for now. And thanks for watching, guys. Subscribe to the YouTube channel and like the Facebook page for regular updates. Give the video a thumbs up if you like it, and do not forget to share it too. Comment below if you have any doubts. I'll surely clear it. And I've also put up the quiz link, so just take a shot at that. And cheers and happy landings, guys. Have a great day. Bye-bye. Take care.